Well, good morning. I am not Chad. He is better looking than me, and so I know you're disappointed in that. I am actually Chris Jones, the student minister here. So I work with students, and it's a real privilege and an honor to be serving in an incredible biblical community of First Baptist Church Allen, and if you have students, it's an honor to be a part of that. They inspire and minister to me, and I cannot tell you how much it's just been a joy to be a part of it. And so it's an honor to be up here. This Sunday, we're actually starting the Road to Easter. This is a new series. Chad is going to be preaching next Sunday leading up to Easter. And of course, Easter is almost here. Spring is here. You can feel it in the air. It's great. Baseball is here. One of the greatest things that happened last night was a miracle. The U.S. beat the Dominican Republic. Yeah, and it's awesome. So I'm into that stuff, and it's going to be great. But one of the things we talk about in Easter is we have these bracelets that we passed out. And so hopefully in your BFGs, if you are not in a BFG, I hope that I want to encourage you to be a part of one, because they are an amazing part of our church family, and they are critical in the growth and discipleship and spiritual discipline of growing in Christ. And so I want to encourage you to be a part of BFG. But in your BFGs, I hope at 10:02, your alarms went off and that you were praying for the Lord of the harvest. We have started this campaign. Jimmy talked about it last week, and you see it in your bulletin. It is 10:02. We have bracelets that the staff is wearing, and it says 10:02, and it says, "I am the workers, go." We are really challenging our church to pray at 10:02, whether it's 10:02 a.m. or 10:02 p.m. We want you to just stop what you're doing and pray for the harvest, the Lord of the harvest, that the laborers will go. And it is just a challenge that we have as a church. Chad, in January, really kind of shared the vision of us going into our communities to share the good news of Jesus Christ, to share the kingdom of God. And that is what we're doing with this 10:02, and that's what we're going to be doing leading up to Easter, is talking about Jesus's ministry. And today we're going to start talking about some of that ministry that Jesus had. And I want to encourage you in this, because what I'm about to do is I'm about to be really just transparent before you. I want to be honest and authentic in what I'm about to share, because for me, I'm very passionate about what God is doing in our church right now. It is amazing to see, just as a staff in the last year, God has really put a passion in our hearts for just going and sharing the good news of Jesus Christ, and how Ross has been talking about it, Jimmy was talking about it, Chad's been sharing about it. And you love when you see a vision when it's not just one person trying to pull everybody, it's everybody coming together and going, "This is what God's doing in my life, this is what God's doing in my life." And to hear the stories of what everybody's talking about, it's amazing, and I'm excited to see every week that journey as we walk along together as a church family. And so today what I want to talk about is us reaching. Anomaly Weekend is coming up in a couple of weeks. That's the student ministry kind of Disciple Now weekend, and the theme is reach. And so I'm kind of talking about reach, but I'm going to talk about what God's really been doing in my heart. And I want to encourage you in this, because as it says in your bulletin, I really firmly believe when we hear the word go, there's a lot of things that kind of come with that. There's a lot of baggage. For me, there's a lot of baggage when I hear the word go. I'm just going to be transparent and say, when Chad was talking about going and sharing the good news of Jesus Christ, when he was saying, go share that with your family, go share that in your community, go share that with your neighbors, go and share that with people, it brings anxiety into my life. Number one, I think back, okay, who does God want me to share with? And, you know, it's kind of hard sometimes in a church, when you work in a church, you're like, well, hopefully all the people I work with, ministers, know Jesus. If they don't, we got a big issue going on, you know? And so it's kind of that thing. So then we start talking about, okay, and then we start talking about our neighbors, and I'm like, oh, my neighbors, you know, they don't like me right now because we got some issues going on here, or I don't talk to them, or I don't even know my neighbors. And so there's a lot of anxiety that comes with that. But what I want to talk about today is that anxiety that comes, that fear that comes, you know? God didn't intend for it to be that way. When we hear go, when I say, I want you to understand what Jesus said when he said, go and make disciples, the first thing that comes to our mind, well, I don't have time. You're asking me to get out of my comfort zone. You're asking me to do things that I just typically don't. But what if it was something different? What if when Jesus said go, that was the freedom for all of us? What if he was giving us freedom in that? Instead of a burden of, I got to go, and so I got to quit my job, or I got to quit my daily life, what if he was wanting us to live in that daily life and go? And it brought a freedom and a salvation that we never could ever dream of. What if it was that way? I firmly believe it's that way. I firmly believe that we've complicated it so much because of the paralyzing fear that we have in it. Because when I would always hear go, what I would always do is I would get so paralyzed by it. It started when I was in high school. When I was 16 years old, I made the decision to surrender and believe and give my life to Christ. And so I did that. But shortly after that, I was in a classroom, and of course, Oklahoma City bombing took place, and we were sitting there watching it live on TV. And my teacher was sitting there, and he was talking, and as he sat there in front of the class, he had the TV on, and he just sat there, and he goes, man, this world needs Jesus. And he walks out of the classroom for a while. He's frustrated. And one of my friends and classmates sit there and looked at me and goes, you go to church, you believe this Jesus? Do you really believe that Jesus is real? And being a teenager, everything in my mind just started racing. Well, if I say yes, then what's he going to think of me? Well, if I say yes, is this going to start an argument? If I say yes, is he going to start making fun of me? Is everybody going to join in on making fun? If I say yes, what is the ramifications of that? And before I could even get that thought process going, all of a sudden, one of my friends in the back was like, well, yeah, he believes in that Jesus. You tell him, Chris. Thanks. Appreciate it, bro. All right. And I just sat silent. And throughout my life, I'm going to be honest, you know, when I hear mission trips and stuff, I'm like, oh, that's for people that are gifted with evangelism. That's the people that know. And so I have a fear of that. And I never went on mission trips to go and share. I went on mission trips that, you know, you could build something or you could do some good social work or, hey, we're going to go and do this for a neighborhood or we're going to go, you know, do all this fun stuff that's going to look good and we're not going to talk to people. And I even went on trips was like, man, I am good as long as I don't have to talk to anybody. How messed up is that? Because in my life, I would look and I would say, man, these guys are more gifted at the knowledge base and all these fun things. And when we're paralyzed, we go into our comfort zone. And so what I started to do was I started to try to gain a lot of knowledge. All right, how do I defend my faith? How do I do all this stuff? And I looked at ways, you know, tricking and, you know, almost became like what Jimmy was preaching about last week about being a jerk. I became that because I was trying to force things on people. Well, you don't believe in Jesus? Let me tell you about it. And I started saying, you know, I'd get with people in apologetics and I'd throw it at them and then they would get so disgusted with me, they wouldn't want to talk anymore. And then that paralyzation fear in my life just kind of, I went back in my shell. And I stand here today, in the back of my mind, these visions of people that I have come across that I never shared the good news of Jesus Christ with. Had opportunities, but I never did. I've had opportunities where I've led funerals of people that I could have shared and I didn't, knowing full well where they are today. And that's where I stand today, wanting to talk to you about what I'm about to approach is sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. And when I say that, everybody goes, well, that's for some gifted people over here. That's not me. That's not something I want to do. But what if it's meant for all of us? What if God intended for all of us to be that way? And that's what I want to talk about today because this, what I'm about to go through, it changed my life. It was like a new creation in my life. I started to see God in a new way. I started to see God as this loving God that didn't give me a burden of go. He gave me a freedom to go. And what I want to do is I want to start talking about it in the Gospel of Luke. Chapter 9, verses 1 through 10. If y'all would turn there because we're going to go through that. And we're going to talk about the disciples. So kind of the little background about Luke 9, 1 through 10 is this. So the disciples, they had, you know, Jesus had gone and he had recruited all these disciples. He had gathered all these disciples. He said, come follow me. He'd done Matthew. He'd said, Peter, you know, Andrew. He had gone through and really walked through the area and said, come follow me. And so he had these 12 disciples that he had that he was picking out of the crowds. You had Matthew, who was a tax collector. That is not a guy I would want to build a kingdom on, is a tax collector. Tax collectors were despised in their culture. Why would you ever want a tax collector? He had Peter, who was a fisherman. We know Peter had a mouth on him. That dude spoke up all the time and said things he shouldn't have ever said. Matter of fact, so much so that Jesus looks at him and says, get behind me, Satan. Whoa. Would you imagine Jesus sitting there looking at you and saying, get behind me, Satan? Like, that's just like Debbie Downer number one. Like, that's just not good. I'm like, okay, I'm done. I can't figure this out. You had Judas, who was going to betray him. So a part of this 12 is just a ragtag group of guys. Guys that you would, if you were doing a fantasy draft of who was going to build your kingdom, they would not be on it. But Jesus called them. He called them. And what he did was, in Luke leading up to this, he sat there and taught them about the kingdom of heaven. He said, this is the kingdom. This is what I am bringing. This is who I am. I am the Son of God. I am coming to bring a new kingdom, a kingdom that brings life, a kingdom that brings freedom, a kingdom that is going to be bigger than you ever dreamed, greater than you ever imagined, and beyond time and space. It's going to be a kingdom that no one can conquer. And I'm coming to tell you about it. And so this is where we start in Luke 9. This is what Jesus says after he begins. He's done teaching them and kind of leading them in that kingdom. And this is what he said. He said, and he called the 12 together and he gave them power and authority over all the demons and to cure diseases. And he sent them out to proclaim the kingdom of God and to heal. The most powerful verse you will ever read is verse 1. Why is that? Look at it. He called the 12 together and gave them power and authority over demons and to cure diseases. He gave them power and authority. Power and authority, think about it. Who has power and authority in a kingdom? When a king goes up to a person, he says, I give you power and authority over my kingdom. It's an ambassador that goes to another nation. When a king approaches somebody and says, I want to give you power and authority, that is someone that is going to represent the kingdom in another nation, and he has the king's words. When an ambassador comes to the United States, they speak for that country. They have the power and the authority of that country. When we send out ambassadors, they have the power and the authority of that country. So what Jesus is saying all right, I've told you about this kingdom. Now what I'm about to do is I'm about to make you an ambassador of this kingdom. Because I'm going to lay the power and authority on you. I'm going to lay the power and authority. And what he did was he brought them together. So he brought them all together. He says, I'm going to make you ambassadors, and I want you to go, and I'm going to give you power over all the demons and to cure diseases. I'm going to give you this power that comes from the kingdom. And he said to them, take nothing for your journey, no staff, nor bag, nor bread, nor money, and do not have two tunics. And whatever house you enter, stay there, and from there depart. How crazy is that? So what he's saying is, he says, I'm going to provide for you. Don't bring anything, I'm going to provide. Can you imagine if Jesus told you, okay, I want you to go, and you're not going to have any provisions? You know what would trip me up in this? Is in whatever house you enter, stay there, and then from there depart. Because if they had a big screen TV and they had a nice little video game system, I would stay there. I would stay there. I would stay there. I love video games. And here's the thing that I love video games, and here's my dirty little confession about video games. So I still play them at the age of 37, yes, all right. I get made fun of at home. My wife is like, she has three boys. It's a confession. But one of the things about life in video games is I met a gentleman named George. George was a guy I met when I was sitting at GameStop 2 years ago, waiting for a game called Fallout 4. We were in line together. Funny thing about George is he's 75 years old. George is an awesome guy. Because I was like, you buying this game for your grandson? He gave me that dirty look like, stay out of my business. And I was like, all right. And he says, what's a guy like you this old in a GameStop for? It's kind of incriminating, isn't it? And I was like, hey, lay off, man. I'm a millennial. And we sit there and we kind of bantered back and forth. This 75-year-old guy, and he goes, well, to be honest with you, I'm buying this game for myself. I just bought a video game system, and I need something to do. I'm 75. My wife just passed away. And my family moved me here to Allen. I'm alone. I'm by myself. I don't have anything, so video games is what kind of keeps me busy. I'm young and spry, so I don't really hang out with the residents. I'm too young for them. And I'm like, you're 75, man, come on. And he goes, yeah, you know. So he's playing this video game. We kind of hit it off, and we start meeting. We're playing the video game together. We're talking over, you know, the communication of the video game. We meet together at Starbucks, and we're just kind of talking. I don't want to approach religion. He knows that I work for First Baptist Allen. I'm the student minister here. We're kind of just talking about things we did, life in general, and things that are going on in his life. And we get to the point where he starts asking kind of questions about the faith. And he really kind of starts hitting some of these questions. And he finally says, do you really believe that believing in Jesus is the only way? That comfort, whatever house you enter, stay there, and from there depart. Man, that's what tripped me up, that comfort. He asked me, do I really believe that? Yeah, I do. He goes, then answer this question for me. So you believe that Jesus is the only way, that outside of Jesus, everyone that doesn't believe, surrender their life and believe in this, dies and goes to hell. Yes, I believe that. He goes, so here's the reality and the truth if I accept this. My wife passed away never believing this. If I accept this truth that you're telling me right now, I'm accepting that my wife is eternally in hell. Is that true, Chris? And looking at me, watery eyes, struggling with this truth. I went back to my 16-year-old self, quiet, hoping somebody would speak up. I took a deep breath, and I said, man, yes, it's true. It's true. And he goes, that's sad. He got up. He walked out of the store. And I didn't see him for 2 months. I was out of my comfort zone. Just like when the disciples, whatever house you stay at, stay there and depart. God's called us to be uncomfortable. It was a hard reality. And the thing is it pushed me a little bit, and it comes back to that time where I struggle with sharing my faith. Because of those moments right there, the hard moments in life. And Jesus said, he said, and whatever they do not, and whenever they do not receive you, when you leave that town, shake the dust from your feet as a testimony against them. We read that, and that's hard. I had to walk away from a Starbucks with a man that I had gotten to know really well, thinking I would never talk to him again. Understanding that, you know what, God, I got to place it, and it was very difficult. And so I did. I took what Jesus said here, and I did. I knew that I was departing that house, and I had to shake the dust and trust that God was going to do what he was going to do. It's hard. And it goes on in verse 6. It says, and they departed and went through the villages, preaching the gospel and healing everywhere. And so we see that the disciples, this is what they're doing. They're planting seeds. He didn't say, I want you to go save them. I want you to go proclaim. You see that when he says in verse 2, he said, he sent them out to proclaim the kingdom of God and to heal. And he said to them, take nothing for your journey, no staff, nor bag, nor bread, nor money, and do not have two tunics. You just take what's on your back and you go. This is hard. This is tough. It's reality. It's what God's called us to. But what he's showing us in this is he's showing us that he wants to provide. He wants to be at the center of our life. He wants us to represent him. He wants the power and authority. He wants us to be his ambassadors. But here's the crazy part about this. And this is what I love about all that goes on in this. The movement that took place right after this. So these disciples, ragtag group of guys, went two by two, as we see in Matthew. They went two by two out into the city. Look what happens in verse 7. Now Herod, the tetrarch, heard about all that was happening, and he was perplexed, because it was said by some that John had been raised from the dead, by some that Elijah had appeared, and by others that one of the prophets of old had risen. Herod said, John I beheaded, but who is this about whom I hear such things? And he sought to see him. And then we see the movement. These 12 guys. So Jesus had 12 guys. He set out with 12 guys. He said, I want you to go two by two out into the community. I want you to go proclaim the kingdom of God. I don't want you to take anything. I want you to trust in me. I'm giving you a power and authority. You go. Scary stuff. But what we see happening because of that faithfulness, because they're proclaiming the God, the leaders of Jerusalem, what was happening was impacting so much that Herod, who had just beheaded John, thought John was coming to haunt him again. This is the same Herod, when the crucifixion happens, goes, I want to see Jesus because I want to know who this is that is proclaiming a different kingdom. I want to know this guy because it's transforming the community around me. It's transforming everything. There's something disrupting who our daily life is. It was changing the whole landscape of what was happening in Jerusalem. And Herod wanted to know. It was impacting Herod. It was transforming him. He was sitting there asking questions. And it was because 12 guys went out into the communities and represented the power and authority of God, ambassadors into Jerusalem to start changing the community for the kingdom of God. But it doesn't stop there. What's crazy is in verse 10. On the return, the apostles told him all that they had done. And he took them and withdrew apart from the town called Bethesda. You know what's crazy about that? Is that's the beginning of the 5,000. The feeding of the 5,000. The 5,000 came because of what the disciples were doing. There was a movement. There was a movement that took place. And all of a sudden, out of nowhere, it went from 12 people following Jesus to 5,000 showing up. And what we read in the 5,000 is, we read that they were running around a lake trying to get to the disciples and Jesus because they wanted what they were preaching. They wanted this kingdom so bad. So much so that they forgot their provisions. They didn't have anything. They just had their tunic. Crazy, right? They were so passionate about what God was going to do that they were actually doing what he told the disciples to do. They ran around seeking after God, seeking after this kingdom. And then we see that one of the greatest miracles in Scripture, Jesus feeds 5,000 people. Jesus feeds them. But he feeds them the kingdom of God first. He teaches them, and they're desperate to hear it so much they forget about all the provisions in life. They forget about all the worries in life. They forget about all the brokenness that's going on. They want to partake in the kingdom of God. And the disciples are proclaiming this. They're the ambassadors. So why do I tell this story when it talks about going? Jesus has called us all to be ambassadors. He's called us all to be ambassadors. And this is what I love about it, because in that, when we look at ambassadors, this is what he says in Isaiah 41:10. He says, fear not, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. And he says that in Isaiah. He says that in Hebrews. He says that in Romans. He says that throughout the Gospels, constantly reminding, I am with you. I am with you. I am giving you that power and authority. I am giving you that everything. And then Paul reminds the church in Corinth that you are ambassadors of Christ. Listen to this, and this is what every follower of Christ, y'all, like, if you memorize any scripture in your life, 2 Corinthians 5:17 through 21 is the scripture, because it is the gospel message in what we're to do, the simplicity of it. It says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away, behold, the new has come. All this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against him, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. Therefore, we are an ambassador for Christ. Get that? Therefore, we are an ambassador for Christ. We represent. We're not out there trying to save the world. We're representing what's going to save the world. We represent God making his appeal through us. We implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake, he has made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. That is the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ, that he wants us to represent day in and day out in our lives. He wants us to surrender to that. And hear me out. This is one of the hardest statements that I have had to reconcile myself with. In our life, I hear it all the time. I hear that we sit there and we'll say, man, Satan is just attacking me. Satan is just is my enemy, and he is attacking me right now. And here's what I want to tell you. Satan is not our greatest enemy. Our greatest enemy is lostness. It's lostness, and it is so prevalent outside these walls. There are people in our daily lives, from our family to our coworkers to our friends to people that we interact with on a daily basis, that are lost, and they are going to die and be separated from God for eternity. Lostness has killed, stealed, and destroyed so many people. And it's a reminder, every death that has happened in this world is a reminder that lostness is our greatest enemy, because it is what separates us from the love of God. Lostness is prevalent everywhere we go. It is prevalent in our communities. It is prevalent in our lives. It is prevalent in our families. And that is the greatest enemy that we face today. Lostness is the greatest enemy because it is so overwhelming. It can consume our fears and everything that we are, because we look out and we see so much lostness and we have so much fear of it. Lostness is our greatest enemy. Because Satan is happy with us being comfortable in our pew. He's cool with that. He's cool with this right now. Because as long as we're away from the world, man, we can't overcome that enemy. We can't do anything about it. But you know what? There is a way. In my life, so many of y'all probably experienced this too. When I would go to conferences, especially in college and in high school, one of the things the pastors would always say, and they do it today, even at some of the conferences that some of the students and college students will go at, and I heard this at a conference just 2 months ago. They'll sit there and do this chant, man, we're the world, you're going to be the world changers. Your generation is going to change the world. I heard that all the time, like, your generation is going to be the ones to come and change the world. You're going to be a world changer. You go out and know that you're a world changer. And I believe that hype. I believed every bit of that. I was like, yeah, I'm going to go out and change the world. And I'd go out for 5 minutes and then I'd be like, whoa, wait, this is too overwhelming. The lostness is very prevalent. And I would go back to my comfort. Here's what I want to tell you. We're not world changers. The world changer happened 2,000 years ago in a man named Jesus Christ. He changed the world. He changed the world. I can't change the world. There is nothing in the world that I can do that will change it for anything. Christ already changed it. My job is to go and proclaim that change. My job is to make him the center of the world. My job is to make him the center of my life. My job is to sit there and proclaim the kingdom of God in everything that I do, whether it's in my family, whether it's on social media, whether it's in my coworkers, whether it's in just in the community. Whatever I do, I am proclaiming as an ambassador of the kingdom of God, his message of hope, his message of love, his message of grace. I can't change the world by making this fantastic tweet that everybody goes, well, that's amazing, Chris. I'm going to accept Jesus and I'm going to go out and change. It doesn't happen that way. It happens by building relationships and understanding the authority doesn't come from us. The power doesn't come from us. We're not the world changers. Christ is the world changer. We just have to abide in him and allow his authority and his power to work in us and through us, to surrender to that, to not wake up every morning going, man, the world, it depends on me to change it. When I think that, I want to stay in bed all day. Because you put on the news and you're like, well, can't change that. See you later. Check out. But when I understand that God's called me to be an ambassador, and here's the beauty of it, he's called all of us to be ambassadors. When I said that verse 1 is the most powerful verse you can ever see, I wasn't lying in that. And he called the 12 together, the church. He calls us together. He calls us together to be the ambassador. See, the thing is about church, it's not a building, it's not a name. It's a group of ambassadors coming together to be the light to a community with like vision, with like-mindedness, with the same authority and power of Jesus Christ, knowing that he has given our life for all of us. And we come together as an encouraging part of sharing the gospel, to share stories of what we've done through the week and sharing of how we've been an ambassador. Because see, the disciples, that's what they did. On the return, the apostles told him that they had done. They were excited. They were alive. They were free. Can you imagine coming to church every Sunday and you're celebrating what God has done through you? Not what you've done, but what God has done through you. Can you imagine that freedom of saying, man, look what God has done. Look what God has done. When I look back over the course of the ministry in my life, I think back to God's command to go and how I set out to change the world. The fact is that the command to go wasn't for me to change the world, but for Christ to change me. To be transformed into the likeness, understanding his great love beyond just a simple phrase and into a mosaic that will forever impact me with the people I have encountered. What I set out to save the world, others ended up saving me in the end. The resurrection didn't stop 2,000 years ago. It continues today through you and to so many others in our life. You find freedom in that. And here's what I want to tell you. This world's made up of two people. Those that are broken and those that are seeking God. There was a time in my life when I was not full of joy and I struggled with peace. I had anxiety in my life. And I was broken. And then I heard the good news of the kingdom of God, that Jesus Christ had come. And after that, I found peace in him. I found hope in him. And I found a new life in him. The thing is, we understand that this world is broken. We know that, but we see, just look outside. You step outside today and you know the world's broken. For some of you, you know the world's broken because it's a constant reminder of the things that are going on in your life. You walked into this room with a heavy burden of the brokenness of this world. There are things that go on around us that we see the brokenness. It's evident. And we understand that this is not how God designed it. See, in the beginning, God designed it for us to have a deep, abiding relationship in him. That everything was to be perfect. That we were to live with him, walk with him, partake in fellowship with him. And that's the way we were designed in full completeness. Not feeling the burdens of the world, but understanding that he was wanting to provide them through the kingdom that he designed. But because of sin of disobedience, that we decided that we had better things planned, that we had better knowledge of things. Because of that sin, we ended up all in brokenness. We sit in brokenness. And yeah, you know what? We try to design things to get out of that brokenness. We try religion. That doesn't get us out of brokenness. We try jobs. But then those go away and we're still sitting in brokenness. We try money. We have plenty of it. But then it all goes away in one fell swoop. And here we are broken again. We try relationships. We try families. We try all this stuff of trying to get out of brokenness. But when those things fail us, we are back in brokenness. We're trapped. We're trapped in brokenness. But God loved us so much that he gave us a way out. He gave us a door. That way out is Jesus Christ, his son, who he sent to this broken world to live with us in that brokenness, to experience that brokenness, to shed tears over deaths, to see the lostness, the enemy that we faced in Lazarus dying, that permanence that we know that we all face. And Jesus came, gave his life for us, took on our sin, took on our disobedience, took on our what we thought was good knowledge of getting us out of, you know, the God design. He took it on, and then 3 days later, he overcame death by being raised. And no longer were we tied to death. No longer was death something that we were tied to because we had a way out through Jesus. And those that in brokenness want out, they can. If they surrender their life and believe in the good news of Jesus Christ. If they surrender to God and make him Lord of their life, King of their life, and believe that Jesus came and did those things. And when those that make that decision to surrender and believe, they begin to grow. grow into God's design over time in a journey. We're not going to be perfect. We're going to keep on making mistakes, but we are growing, growing in Him. And then we go as ambassadors back into the brokenness to proclaim that which has given us hope, which is what I'm doing today. See, the thing is, the story of George doesn't stop with him walking away. 2 months had gone by. George calls me. Hey, Chris, can we meet? I want to talk to you about something. Yeah, awesome. He says, man, I want to just thank you. I've been thinking about what you said. And Friday, I really felt God leading me. God leading me to go to church. And so I called my family and I said, hey, let's go to church. My family hadn't been to church in a long time. I said, let's just go to church. Let's all just go to church. And so that Sunday they went to church. And he says, I don't know what it was, Chris, but I was sitting in the seats in there and God tugged on my heart. He walked down front, told the pastor that he wants to surrender and believe in Christ. And he says, the hardest part was knowing that I will never see my wife again. And what's crazy is he goes, Matthew 10 says that I have not come to bring people together, but to separate. Husband and wife, father and daughter, mother, son. All my life I'd heard that scripture, and students have always used it, being in student ministry of, well, I can disobey my parents because this is what God wants me to do. And it was so clear to me in that moment. That's what Jesus was saying. That's what Jesus, because Matthew 10 is where Jesus is telling the disciples as they go out in this scenario, this is what's going to happen. And he goes, I'll never see her again, but I don't want to be separated from God. And he goes, but I do want to tell you this. Through that, I was baptized, but I wasn't baptized alone. He goes, my granddaughter was baptized with me. She's 16. And because of the decision I made, she wanted to talk about it, and I got to share with her. A new believer, and he shares with her. And they got baptized on the same day. It wasn't anything I did. All I understood was I was to be an ambassador. To just go and proclaim the kingdom and just let God work in those amazing moments. I was telling George about this, how I'm preaching on this, and asked if I could tell the story. And he texted me this morning. He says, hey, praying for you. Wish I could be there. But he can't because he's in New York this week with his granddaughter on a mission trip with the student ministry. 75-year-old man. And he sent me a picture of him baptizing 3 believers from New York. Proclaim the kingdom of God is what Jesus commanded us to do. That's all I know what to do. In my life, I've lived so much under my own power and authority. I lived thinking I was the world changer, and I was going to be the one to save others, as if it was me. What I humbly learned in my life is there are 2 types of people in this world, those in brokenness and those that are growing and going in God's design. Kingdom of God ambassadors, you can call them. Which one are you? Which one are you? Are you in brokenness today? Are you trying to solve it by religion, by knowledge, by all these things, trying under your own power to live? Or are you ready to surrender and believe? Allowing Christ to call and give you the power and authority to go and proclaim the kingdom of God. Thing is, I would love to share of just story after story of how God has humbled me in this. How God has shown me that it's not my power and authority that I live under, but His. I just got back from Costa Rica. And I got to experience seeing a young man in a new creation. I got to experience people coming to know the Lord, not by our power, but because of God's. So where do we go from here? Well, first we ask this question. This is why the big question mark is in your bulletin. If you wondered why we had a watermark question mark, that wasn't, we don't know what Chris is preaching today. That was, I knew what I was preaching, but, you know, as a chance card from Monopoly or whatever. But the question is, whose power and authority are you walking with daily? When you look at your life, when you wake up in the morning, whose power and authority? Are you living under your own power and authority? Or are you living under God's? Are you an ambassador? Are you allowing God to speak through you? And what do I mean by that? I don't mean that are you going to the nations. What I'm talking about is in your daily life. When you look around, do you see God working as you proclaim? It's not you, you know, Jimmy said, don't be a jerk about it. I'm not saying you go up into Starbucks and you say, this cup, man, and I mean, you know, you're flinging around, and you're proclaiming the gospel in Starbucks. I'm going to get all these baristas saved. I'm not talking about that. What I'm talking about is living a life in relationship with those people. Are you intentionally going and building relationships? Are you able to know people's lives so much that you can at one point share and proclaim that? And be okay if they reject it, because you know what? Jesus said some are going to reject it, some are going to accept it. But whose power and authority are you living with? And where do you start with it? Here's the thing. Start in your own homes. As a family, start talking about it. As your family begins to talk, here's where I would challenge you is, don't accept, oh yeah, I go to church. Man, that excuse is not what saves you. Anybody can go to church. Anybody can attend a church. Anybody can claim church. What saves you is having a story of how your life was in brokenness and how your life is now in God's design. Share that. Don't settle for, I go to church. Because there are a lot of people in churches today that are separated from God. They're in brokenness. They let the brokenness define them because they think religion is what saves. They think knowledge is what saves. And Satan is just like, go ahead, stay in there and gain all the knowledge because I don't want you out in the fields. Because when you're not out in the fields, you're not impacting the kingdom of Satan. You're not impacting the world. It's a simple step. And what I learned is it's not my power, but God's. It's not my authority, but God's. My job is to proclaim the kingdom of God and be that peace, be the light to the world. I love, there's this pastor that says this, and it's a great encouragement. He always tells people this. If you're in a job or a situation where you're like, it's just complete darkness, here's what I want to encourage you. Go into a room at your house with a flashlight. Turn off all the lights. Turn on that flashlight. Is that room dark? No, because you're the light. Where there is light, there is no darkness. Where you are, you will be the light. The darkness will fade. Darkness only exists when darkness is complete. But when there is light, you can't call it darkness. I want to challenge you with that.